All right, let me tell you about some fuckery. Okay. Let me tell you about some fuckery. So, Monday, I was having a good morning. Morning was great. Went to court, did my thing. My dude went to jail. I was like, sorry, dude. And then I had to go back to the office, and we had a call that there's like an emergency hearing for one of my clients. So I got to drive out to Loudoun. On my way to Loudoun, my windshield gets hit by a rock the size of a plum.
On the most beautiful road in the area?
And yeah, I hate 66. 66 is the asshole of roads. Like, just the worst. But I was like, call my insurance. They're like, yeah, it's going to cost you some money, but we'll cover part of it. We got you set up for Thursday. Bet. Thursday. Dude shows up. Oh, this is a convertible? They don't make another model of the S2000. They're all convertibles. He's like, sorry, dude. This has to be done in the shop. Cool. When? He's like, Saturday. I was like, bet. He's like, next Saturday. I was like, fuck. So, that sucked. Yesterday, I go. My boss has been out for weeks. I cashed 3 of my paychecks because I got bills to pay. I go to my bank. I go to the ATM. I put the money in. It takes the money, and it says error. And I said, what? And it said, please remove your cash. And then it didn't open the cash dispenser. And then it shit my card back out and shut down. So I call the bank. This is my worst nightmare. As a Jew, you're never supposed to let the let anybody else touch the money. I called the bank because it's like 6. They're closed. So I call the main office. And she's like, yeah, we'll open up a claim. Don't worry. There's cameras and stuff. Cool. She's like, it's going to take about 10 business days for us to complete our investigation. And I said, whoa, hold on. What? You realize it's your machine? Like, you just send somebody out here, just pry that bitch up and just count it. It's all there. She's like, there's nothing we can do. She's like, best we can do is credit you a couple $100. It'll be there in 2 to 3 business days. And I was like, you realize Monday's a holiday, right? So you're telling me to go fuck myself until next Friday? Cool. Appreciate you.
What bank is this?
Capital One. Capital One's always been great to me.
Well, I can tell you right now, Capital One, suck a dick, because that's some bullshit.
And this poor lady on the phone, I was just like, get me to somebody who can do something. She's like, I've done everything I can. I was like, I know you have. Give me to the guy who's in the back or whatever. She's like, I can't.
Ryan's no good, terrible week.
it's been a time, you know, but I'm here. I'm healthy.
Yeah. You know what, James, count that done down. We'll talk about the Kyrie thing in a blip.
No, I want to add something else.
Oh, what's up?
I got a notification. I'm getting married on Thursday.
All right.
Good news.
My man.
Good news. All right, now we can count.
So it's good for the black man's bad for the white man.
I'm sure. You going to zoom it from the courthouse?
No. You're the third person to ask me. He's like, oh,
why won't you?
No. No.
A bunch of the courthouses in, that I go to are closed.
What courthouse are you guys going to?
The joint PG County. They only do it on Tuesdays and Thursdays now.
Are you bringing family or anything with you?
No, nobody can go in but us.
Yeah.
No witnesses? They're not allowed? No, wow.
COVID. Yeah, so it's kind of like, yeah, so like the main joint, like everybody will be there. So yeah,
I'm thinking about I'm thinking about showing up with my Zoom camera waiting outside the courthouse for you guys to come out.
Fucker.
You can't stop me.
You don't know which one I'm going to.
The PG County Courthouse?
Yeah, where is it?
In PG County. Google it. There's only one courthouse per district.
All right, fuck's sake. All right, you don't know what time I'm being there.
Like, I don't, like, when a girlfriend goes to work, I can't camp out at a PG County courthouse and listen to podcasts all day. I was a Lyft driver, for Christ's sake. I got a problem with it. I used to sleep.
He had time.
You remember before we would do the live pods, y'all would, what alleyway did you sleep in, Kaneem? Like, it's like, I give a shit.
I remember that. I took a nap in the parking lot.
It was like, yeah. What was the last time you were home?
A homeless guy knocked on my window.
It'd be Saturday morning we're doing the pod. When were you last home? Thursday?
Yeah.
Okay. All right, fine. Fair enough. All right, whatever. All right, so 3.
Oh, yeah. All my courthouses are shut down because of the election or the
Well, you know, all the Virginia bridges. I'm in D.C. right now, and I'm going to be in D.C. all through next week. There's no bridges into D.C. They're shutting them all down on Tuesday.
Oh, yeah. One of my boys was saying that to get into his neighborhood, each street is blocked off by the U.S. military. Mm-hmm. And to get into his neighborhood now, he has to show ID that has that address on there for them to let him in.
Yep. Oh, the city's shutting down.
Oh, yeah. It's fucking wild.
Well,
it's
insane. All right, hold on.
And they got bomb threats.
Can go from 301 to 50 to 210?
Yeah, you're not hitting D.C.
Yeah,
you can't 495. Go in or out of D.C.
Cool. You're not hitting D.C. The American Legion Bridge is going to be open. Yeah, the only two ways into the city from Virginia, other than going like all the way around and through Maryland, mm-hmm. is the Key Bridge and Chain Bridge. That's it. 395, 14th Street, all of it shut down. They already shut down the Memorial Bridge, National, whatever.
Yep. I know. And they shut down all the courts because the Virginia Supreme Court got bomb threats.
Wow. As long as I can get to 50 and 495, I'm good.
Car is full of gas. As soon as I hear a car bomb or anything go off, telling Devin to get the fuck in the car and we're gone.
Yep.
You can come here. I don't think they're going
to
fuck with us.
I'm not going to Virginia. I'm going up to Baltimore. Let them come on my turf, motherfuckers.
I'm just going to hang a swastika outside and figure they'll pass my house over.
You should be Baltimore motherfuckers that don't know how to aim. You're just going to be indiscriminate death. Come up on my turf, all right? Yeah. Let's go.
They'll be like, oh, shit. Use my man's. My bad. All right. All right. 3, 2, 1. Welcome back to All Sorts of Sports. All right.
That's indiscriminate murder right there.
Y'all seen The Wire, right? Where Snoop.
Multiple times.
On the drive-by.
Yeah.
The, dude wanted to spray like West Coast. Yeah. She gets out. And Baltimore, we aim and hit her. Boom.
Oh, my God. All right. So, I don't have much to talk about.
Episode 50, The Admiral David Robinson and Samurai Mike Singletary.
Fair.
I'm a big Singletary guy.
Fair. I can't think of either number 50s. If
not a great coach, but hell of a player.
Hell of a player.
Yeah, true. Fair enough. Admiral.
Very medium to
he was gracious in his retirement because I haven't heard anything from.
Oh no, and you think he'd be like yapping. But the big thing that I always took away from Mike Singletary as a coach was that he rubbed everybody the wrong way because he was the one that constructed like the giant hill of dirt that they had to climb up and down, like professional athletes, and they're like, man, fuck this ain't high school. What the fuck are you talking about? And Vernon Davis was like pissed off at him, but Vernon Davis afterwards said, if it wasn't for his leadership and his coaching, I wouldn't be anywhere near the man that I am today. So in the grand scheme of things.
Also, he's doing insurance Love commercials.
It. Yeah, well, I'm saying I haven't heard anything from him except when he's like on the sideline in Spurs games with Tim Duncan. All right, so don't have a shit ton to get to this week.
Quarterback.
Outside of, hey, my wrist is getting better. And after the last pod, I walked out. I was met with some resistance, and she instantly grabbed my wrist.
Yeah, she instantly grabbed your wrist and told you for the next week what you're going to have to do to rebuild that wrist is a lot of this.
No.
I mean, you're still getting married on Thursday, so I think you win.
I got to tread lightly. All right. So we've had some discussions and arguments through the group chat over this past week. The funniest one, in my opinion, happened, yesterday? When we were discussing, they put out a list of the top 25 defenders so far, like the team defensive rating when they're on the court. Mm-hmm. And Luka was number 6, mm-hmm. which mm-hmm. was hilarious to me. I was like, wow. But I mean, there's a bunch of different factors that go into it, but it is what it is at this point. And KDOT, for some reason, said that Luka was better than Steph Curry.
Stop putting my shit out of context and just throwing up fucking loop like a goddamn Fox News anchor.
You did.
What I was saying and what I was going off of is the same thing that I said when we did the pod when Keem was on here, all right? Mm-hmm. The jury was out for me on Steph coming off the injury. Number one. Number two, I've always said that list that I had, the list that ESPN put together was going into this year with the information we had. But I told you that even after five games when we did that pod, my list looked different. And the only person I was still waiting for was Steph, who I said was just outside of my top five. Just outside of my top five. Right now, there's no discussion. He is definitely in my top five. But what I also found just interesting about the defensive list was that Luka was that high on the defensive list. Steph Curry's not in the top, I think, went to 20? He ain't in the top 25. 20. He ain't in the top 25. Neither was Kawhi, which is crazy, right, as far as Kawhi goes. But you have Steph wasn't in the top 25. He is the, what, number two scorer behind Brad? Or is Bradley he number Beal. One? Number two? Bradley Beal is number Brad. One. Right. But Luka is in the top seven in scoring, and he's also in the and he was also, I forget where he was on the defensive league. He always said seven?
Six.
So if I'm looking at that, and I'm looking at the list as a power ranking, which is the way that I look at the list, then I'm saying right now, here today.
But what I tell you?
Luka's playing better than Steph.
What I tell you about that list?
What?
That list was only discussing the defensive rating of the team when that player's on the court. So
oh, you never told me you that.
I said that right up because it is not just Luka being on the court, but it's the rotations that Rick Carlisle's doing. He's not throwing Luka out there like just by himself.
I'm saying one on one Luka defending an ISO is a shutdown. I'm not doing that. I'm saying
No. He's not good
right
at that point.
All I'm saying is that, like, if I was looking at the list, that information kind of skews it just a bit. But what I was looking at that list as far as, like, defensive – because even Brendan, who was on the podcast a few weeks ago, mm-hmm. I sent him the list. He's like, how the fuck is Luka there? And I was like
– Everybody's saying that. You know why? Because when you watch the game, there are multiple plays every time when you look and you're like, what the fuck is Luka doing?
He's fat. He's not in game shape yet.
At the end of the day,
it's the effort.
At the end of the day, what it comes down to me is fuck the ESPN list for right now.
Yeah.
I'm looking at the standpoint at the end of the year when we're looking at who's going to be MVP, mm-hmm. which is, to me, it's the best of that year. Doesn't mean mm-hmm. you had the best career. Doesn't mean you're projected to have the best career. None of that. Sure. Just what you have right here. Mm-hmm. I don't see any circumstances in which Luke is not going to finish ahead of Steph, number one. And number two.
No.
That, okay. I'm saying for me, my list right now, and it's
on. Right, what's the Warriors at the two seed?
Then I think it could change. But we're talking about what ifs. These are all predictions, right?
Yeah.
My predictions is still Joel number one, which is still looking good as far as MVP right now. Joel's looking amazing, right?
What happened to. All right, so who's number two? Out.
Number two was Luka.
All right, who number three?
Number three was AD. That was my list.
I know, but all right. All right. Okay.
Because I don't think they're going to give Giannis the third MVP. And then outside of not giving Giannis the third – because, look, to get in the conversation of having three MVPs, you better have a fucking championship. I just think from a standpoint of politics, they're not going to give it to Giannis. So outside of that, if I'm looking at that list, Joel looks amazing. Luka looks damn good. And not to mention, if you got a lot of lists like that going on Twitter and nobody's breaking down the full explanation, then idiots like me say, damn, Luka's amazing.
Nah, but like when the person posted the list, right, or whatever, and then right under it, someone like commenting was like, all right, this is misleading as fuck. Because clearly, like when they looked at like whoever compiled the list, they were like, yeah, this is talking about the rating of the team as a whole when that player's on the court. And then, I mean,
which makes you very valuable.
No, I mean, not in Luka's case, because it's more so the people around him. Like, you look at the free agents we signed.
It is always going to be.
It was all about defense.
Always going to be the people around you, right? It's in the same sense of like when you got Draymond, it could turn into a shutdown at some point. You got Iguodala, that could turn into a shutdown. Not right now necessarily, but over the years. Yeah. It's about all the guys that you got on the court at the same time. Because, I mean, at a certain angle, if you got a certain guy going one-on-one against another, there's a lot of variables in it.
Who was number one? Do you remember?
On that list?
Yep. Drummond.
Huh?
Drummond, who had 33 and 23 last night.
Yeah, God, but you know who I don't see on here?
Kawhi.
Or anybody from the Warriors. Interesting.
I mean, were they ever a real defensive team?
No, that's what Draymond, Iguodala at certain Draymond, points. That's what they always had Draymond certain Green guys that came in and do it.
Still a very good defender. But I'm just saying, when Draymond and Steph are on the court, I don't see them on this list.
Steph's not.
Kyle Kuzma's on this goddamn
Steph's,
list.
Steph's not even really a defender, though.
Right, but if you're saying it's the people around you, and they still have Draymond, why isn't he on this list?
Draymond's not like a shutdown fucking defender, and it's about more than just one other guy. I'm talking about the other four.
Ooh, Anthony Davis is number five on this list. That's weird.
But I think the other part of this that I'm trying to consider, and I'm going to pull this up because I listened to the entire old podcast to try to figure out what was up. James, you were talking about your MVP.
What was up to
figure out what it is that we were all talking about when it comes to MVP, to hold us accountable, okay? Mm-hmm. You had Luka number one for MVP. You got KD number two for MVP. You got Giannis number three. So why are you looking at me like I'm out of my fucking mind when I say this stuff's not on my MVP list?
I'm talking about – no, I didn't say – I'm not talking about the MVP.
Like, you're talking about the power
ranking debate was saying like right now you're saying that Luka's better than Steph, and I was like, nah.
I mean, he's playing better than Steph.
Right. Steph's putting on a clinic. It's hard for me to try to dish. I'm not what anything is I clinic, say negative though?
He
about
shoots,
Steph.
He shoots 30 times a game. And he makes like seven shots. To me, that's not a clinic.
Not always. Not always. He's shooting better than that most nights.
Let's just let Ryan be what it is, because Ryan don't like Steph. We already established that. All right.
See, that's the thing. Get it straight. Ryan hates Steph Curry. Yeah. I do not hate Steph Curry.
No, you don't hate him. You didn't believe in him in the start of the year.
I didn't believe 100%. My jury was out for me. Fair. 100%.
All right. So
here's my argument. Well, just so because you're putting words in my mouth. I don't hate Steph Curry. I think he's a star. I just don't think he's a superstar. He can't put a team on his shoulders, in my opinion.
What?
Wait till this season. You know wait till this season plays out, and they're a trash team. They're trash. Team's trash.
You know why? You know why? Because we were looking for somebody else to come on the show and debate, and they're gonna debate your ass. Because what the fuck is that? Are you serious?
Yeah, no, he's not a superstar.
Oh my God,
he was 4 years ago. He's not the same player now.
I think that's ridiculous. But here's but what I gotta ask.
How ridiculous?
The jury's still out for one thing for me, okay? Mm-hmm. Which is that I get Steph is amazing.
Yeah,
I still have the jury to me is still a little out on whether or not Steph can carry a team by himself. Because there's not a lot of guys.
That's the definition of a superstar, though.
But there's not a lot of
able to carry the team.
But the list of people that can do that is almost slim to none. I don't think Luka can carry a team by himself. I think Giannis, yeah. LeBron, absolutely.
KD.
But even right now, up in age, I don't even know if I'd give it to LeBron right now to carry a team all by himself.
Dude, they were down by 20 points to the Pelicans, and then AD and LeBron were like,
let's play now.
Steph do the same thing.
Hold on, but we also saw LeBron. We saw LeBron in a full season with the Lakers without AD, and we saw how that ended up. So I'm just saying, there are certain guys that can carry a team depending on where they're at in their careers.
Right.
I don't know as far as Steph, because Steph, honestly, has Steph ever had to do it? I just don't know. I've never seen him do it.
Okay. All right. So I'm not going to debate y'all on this. I'm going to let people come on this show and debate y'all on this because this shit's going to be fun.
Has Steph ever carried a team by himself?
No. He just said Steph's not a superstar. I think that's ridiculous.
Okay,
I know. Right, I'm letting people debate that. I'm not doing it. All right. So let's go into another topic of somebody that we all equally dislike at the moment. James Harden. I don't know what's up with Kyrie. Like, personal business, I don't know what it is, so I'm not going to speak on it. I hope everything's okay. But with James Harden, his first press conference with the Nets. Did y'all watch it?
Nope.
Okay. So the reporters asked some good questions. My favorite one was, do you regret like coming off as disrespectful to the Rockets and all the other stuff?
I kind of wish I saw this.
Yep. Your man said, I don't feel like I was disrespectful. And I was like, huh? You know that meme when dude's like, huh? Yeah. The fuck is he talking about? And then I think somebody asked him about his conditioning, and I believe he just smiled.
I mean,
the favorite meme is like when he gets to Brooklyn, like as soon as he steps off the flight to Brooklyn, he's just going to take off the fat suit.
You saw on the cover photo for last pod, I had Mark Henry in the...
Yeah. And then Kyrie was absent.
Here's the thing. Look, I'm more interested in the Kyrie thing right now when it comes to the Brooklyn Nets than I am interested in the James Harden thing. Because to me, I don't think anybody thinks Harden can't ball. I just think people need to figure out whether or not he cares to ball. So I was watching Inside the NBA.
James Harden.
He's got to care. Look, we just saw in Houston was him not caring. Did you see the pass that he made to Wall and Wall looked at him like, I'm going to fucking wring your goddamn neck.
Yeah,
the lazy ass bullshit.
He's like he wanted to get out of there.
That's what I'm saying. Is that there's a difference? I don't think anybody thinks Harden can't ball. It's just choosing whether or not he wants to. And I think right now, I was watching Inside the NBA, and what I was blown away by was that Shaq and Chuck had basically the exact same thing to say about him that I had to say about him, which is that Houston has done everything that you fucking asked of him. Yep. You wanted to play with your best friends in fucking Little League and James and Russ? We gave it to you. You wanted Dwight Howard? We gave him to you. You wanted Chris Paul? We gave him to you. Look, you had stellar teams. You were almost there. To then cut bait on a team and to be disrespectful, regardless of whatever it is you think you're being, is bullshit. So if you can't show up in Brooklyn without getting a championship, you have failed, sir. And beyond, you have failed miserably. You are an absolute asshole, and you are a failure if you don't bring a championship. Even with the Lakers being the Lakers, not getting to the finals is not enough now.
They're not going to, though.
And that's the point, is that it's already filled in that you have failed.
Yeah.
So the only person I'm looking at with that Brooklyn team that I know is going to show up and ball with no excuses in it, day in and day out is KD. Yeah. Beyond that, the jury is out on all them fuckers. And Kyrie... You know, before I get into the Kyrie bag, does anybody else have anything they want to say about Harden?
I do.
I do too.
Yeah, I do. So, I think the most telling character trait for James Harden is when he sat there and lied and said he gave Houston everything he had.
Mm-hmm.
Look, I don't know if – I know Harden can ball. He can put on 40 pounds and put up 40 points. Doesn't matter. Mm-hmm. My issue is I guess maybe the Rockets should kind of look in the mirror a little bit, because maybe giving him all these things that he wanted may have not been the best thing for the team as a whole, because obviously they couldn't get it done when it mattered. Mm-hmm. But two, once you start doing those things – who's really running the team? And then does that make him feel entitled that when he wants out, he can just, you know, be a big baby about it and, you know, play lazy basketball? I'm surprised John Wall didn't shoot him. I don't have any respect for him anymore as an athlete. Like I don't know who he is like as a person, but that's not how you treat a franchise that has gone above and beyond and bent over backwards to make sure that you're not only are you happy, but that you have the pieces around you and the tools around you to succeed. And then you fail them. You fail them over and over and over and over again.
What's his record in elimination games?
I don't think did they win one?
And what is his stat line in elimination games?
He disappears. He's like Bradley Beal in the fourth quarter. He's just, where is he? I don't know. And my issue is, I think if I'm KD right now, I'm fucking pissed, because I got one guy, I got two guys, the two superstars other than myself, and I don't know if they want to play.
So he is, so he's played in four game sevens, and he's averaging 24 points on 40% shooting. He's played in 19 elimination games in his playoff career, and in those games, he's averaging 23.8 points on 41.5% shooting.
That's awful.
What's it in from three?
Like less than 30%, like 20. I forget. I looked up the stat when I watched that Shaq thing.
Oh, wow. He shot 2 of 11 three times now?
You see what I'm saying?
But wait, wait, wait. So I wanted to say, like, two things. So, number one, you were discussing Shaq's comments earlier, and he said something that Ryan was saying about, like, you can't say you gave Houston everything, and then you look at your effort this year so far. Is disrespectful. And then number two,
and that's coming in from regards Shaq.
To yeah. And number two, let's not forget that maybe like a year or two ago, there was 10-minute highlight tapes of James Harden not playing defense.
Yep.
Like it's like when your controller dies.
Yeah. And it's just like you look and it's like, yo, what are you doing? And then like you find yourself saying it like 40, 50 times in a 10-minute video. So
yeah, and it look, the thing is,
and I think James, is your phone near the near your mic or anything?
Yep, it's James. I saw him grab the phone. So and I think you talked about this. I lost my train of thought when we started talking about the phone.
Sorry.
What were you talking about?
We were talking about James Harden not playing defense and how the Nets got worse defensively.
And we've been talking about this in a different context. Can James Harden change his style of play if he wants to win? He's not old. What is he, like 31, 2? He's young, right?
He's somewhere around that range.
Yeah. If he wants to win a championship with Brooklyn, one, he's going to have to show up every day. Two, he's got to stop eating 14 meals a day. And three, he's got to learn to play defense. Because if you're going to shoot 30% from three and 40% when you're taking 40 shots a game, you have to be able to play defense to prevent them from scoring also. Like, he's not a bad player. He just needs to adjust a few things. One is mindset, too. That if he's going into Brooklyn thinking he's the king, he's wrong. It's KD, in my opinion. But if I'm KD, I'm pissed. I have two players who are supposed to be my big three out of the big three, and I don't know if they want to play.
Well, Sean Marks said,
"Where the fuck is Kyrie?"
And what is James Harden doing? He consulted with both of them,
of course,
before making the trade. So like, they're on board.
But
that goes back to what I've been saying on the pod for weeks: is that if I'm KD, the reason I want the Harden trade is because I don't trust Kyrie. My thought is that one of those two guys is going to get me enough to do it. It might not be both of them. And the other aspect of what Ryan is talking about, as far as the change of style of game, we saw Harden went from being the sixth man in Oklahoma City, and everybody was rooting for him because we knew he had talent, but they couldn't get him in the rotation. So he goes to Houston, becomes his own guy. He becomes the beard, right? And he's been the guy to facilitate almost everything that's happened on offense. When you've got Kyrie, KD, and James Harden on the same team, they're going to have to put your egos to the side to figure out who's going to get these touches. Because everybody's touches is about to go down. Because you got three guys that like to handle the fucking ball. And this is where it's got to be from going forward. Is you got to figure out where that balance is. And we're not sure where Kyrie's head's at, even though I kind of want to get into that a little bit more. But when it comes to Harden, dude, he's got to take another step somewhere. Right now, I think that there's just as equal a chance that Brooklyn crashes and burns as it is that they become great, because they got enough talent to be great. It's just a matter of where's your mindset. Can KD rub off on enough of them to get them to get it out of the fucking stupid ways?
I mean, look, they lost a bunch of defensive pieces. Yep. They lost their depth off the bench. Like,
which we were harping on why they would be good at the beginning of the season. Yeah, we were like, but their bench is so deep. They got great defensive players, and now they're all gone.
There's still something that, look, regardless of how you feel about the players they lost on defense, the talent level of those three and the offensive opportunities and scoring ability of those three is enough to offset a lot. If they can get on the same page. And I'm not high. I'm not a huge Kyrie guy. I'm not a huge Harden guy. I like KD a lot. That's if they can get it worked out, that is a fucking squat. I don't care what anybody says. That's that that how the fuck do you stop them if they can gel?
That's Milwaukee.
Their biggest what do you mean ask Milwaukee?
I feel like Milwaukee would do
some. I'm just saying that like it's the same way I felt about the Warriors at a certain point when the Splash Brothers were going off, which is regardless of whatever it is you're trying to do on defense, you're not going to be able to stop all those goddamn lob-lobs. And beyond that, you could do what you want to do, but they're just going to outscore you.
You said
and,
stop all the what?
Lob-ups, just throwing the ball up. There's a, right. There's a, whatever. There's a...
Lob-lobs.
I was like, what word did you just say?
KD in history will go down as one of the best, if not the best scorer of all time. As far as being able to do it from anywhere on the court. You could say Steph, I get it, but I'm saying as far as just variety of ability to make anything go, KD is incredible.
KD's a goat, yeah.
Kyrie has shown flashes of being great. Not just
the best handles.
Best handles in the league, it's not even close, right? Yeah. And then you have James Harden, who, regardless of whatever it is that anybody feels about his defense, which is questionable as shit, all of us were saying the same thing going leading up to this trade. He's easily a top five player. Right? And beyond that, he is probably right now today the best pure scorer in the league.
The combination of three is insane to me. Get to the rack, score.
Which is why they leveraged everything to make this work, which is where I don't think KD... I think they got a two-year window before KD says, I don't give a fuck what's happening here, I'm out.
But yeah, his contract's up in 2023.
Huh?
I believe his contract's up in 2020.
We also realize that NBA players do not have to stay anywhere they don't want to stay.
And if it's a dumpster fire, I wouldn't be surprised if KD's out after this year.
Come to Washington, KD.
Yeah, because like you'd be like, all right, so this didn't work, so get all the draft picks you can for me.
And if you – I hate the Lakers. We all know this. But if you see what the Lakers have done in terms of getting the ball around – sometimes LeBron's the highest scorer. Sometimes it's AD. Sometimes it's like Montrezl will put up like fucking 20 points last night. They know how their team works. And because they know that, they know how to win with their team. My worry with the Nets is it's just going to be three superstars on the same court, which, you know, battling over who gets the most touches, who gets the most points. Kyrie going to pass the ball? Is James Harden going to pass the ball? Is KD going to get pissed because it's a power struggle? I don't know.
And see, the other aspect of it is a lot of those teams, if you look at like LA or even Golden State, when you have that squad around, but you've had to mortgage a lot to get that squad, usually you have a lot of veteran role players to be like, yo, I'll take a pay cut to go win me a championship here with these guys. With what Harden did to Boogie and Wall in Houston, there are going to be a whole plethora of dudes in the NBA to say, I ain't want to have not a goddamn thing to do with this dude. There's another group of guys that are going to look at Kyrie and be like, I don't even know if he's going to show up to play. So the fact that
there's more other super teams around.
Right? Like, so while I might want to play with KD, KD's a destination, I ain't putting up with that shit.
Yeah. So, I mean, jury's out, but I still think Milwaukee matches up well.
But let me can I get in my Kyrie bag just a little bit?
Oh yeah, go ahead.
So if anybody it was all over Twitter, Jackie McMullen, who's known longtime sports writer.
Yeah.
She does a lot of guest spots with like Bill Plaschke and some other guys. Around the horn, but she's also on the Ringer a lot with Bill Simmons and Ryan Russillo and those guests. And look, Bill Simmons can be problematic as hell for a lot of people. I'm a fan. I subscribe to almost everything on the Ringer. Man, I listen a lot.
When Joe had COVID, he tried to teach him how to do Zoom so he can continue the podcast. That's bullshit.
No, the worst part about it was when Joe said, yo, my dad is sick. And he's like, yeah. Oh, yeah. But the Zoom thing, though. So it was like that was the one thing with Bill. I was like, oh, okay, Bill. Plus, just the way he talks about Boston sports and whatever. I'm a fan of a lot of his products, even though they lost Jason Concepcion, who had the best NBA show online at one point. Jack McMullen says that basically she's talked to Kyrie over the years because she knows a lot of players. She's well-respected for the most part. And when she was talking to Kyrie, she was saying that The whole Capitol protest, everything that's happened after the Jacob Blake situation, everything that's happened as far as the Black Lives Matter and all that is really affecting Kyrie. And she said in one of those conversations she had with Kyrie, Kyrie was saying, look, I don't even know if we should have an NBA draft. Like, it just feels wrong. It just feels like we don't have the same freedom. We're like, we're not property. And Jackie says, well, Kyrie, you are property. Like, they pay you a certain amount of money to basically be property. That's a problematic ass statement. No getting around it.
And she's stupid as fuck for putting it out there.
It's a problematic ass statement. That being said, she ain't wrong.
Well, and she's not stupid. That was stupid.
That's she ain't wrong. It's the same way that we can sit here and talk about the things like the NFL Combine, which looks like a goddamn buck show. Kyrie should have that mentality. I understand Kyrie feeling a certain way about it. I can understand all these things affecting Kyrie in a certain way. The only problem that I have with Kyrie here at this particular point in time is that what I said on the last show, most of what Kyrie does good is not because of what he says. It's what he's doing with his actions as far as putting the dollars and cents behind a lot of organizations and doing the right thing. And I give him a lot of props for that. But in order to do that, you got to play because to have the money to do that shit. But if Kyrie wants to have those conversations about how problematic the NBA draft is, if he wants to talk about the NFL Combine, if he wants to talk about the entire legacy of the way that sports really works, which is almost every major sports league is majority colored, and outside of it being colored, you have the owners are all white, except for Shad Khan and Jimmy Haslam, it feels problematic. If he wants to have that discussion, talk to people and let's bring it to the forefront. There should never be a situation where you're just disappearing, where nobody knows what the fuck you're doing. Because even if I find out that you're being educated on something, there's still a part of me in the back of my head that's like, Kyrie, you don't know what the fuck you're talking about. You don't know. Because you do so many stupid shit. Like, regardless of whatever it is you feel about Black Lives Matter and the Capitol protest, why the fuck are you at a birthday party without masks in the middle of a pandemic? Fuck off. There's a certain limit of which I can give you props, but there's another element of it where I'm like, nah, fuck that. You're not getting it out. And I think Jackie McMullen right now has become this big out for this Kyrie bullshit, where it is we still need to hold Kyrie accountable to the shit that he's doing. What Jackie said out of context as a white woman talking about black players is fucked up and wrong. It feels wrong. But she ain't wrong. It is problematic. The fact that you have an NBA draft to take these kids that they are forcing to go to college for no money and then put them in a pool and have these great white guys choose which one we want to be ours is problematic. Let's have that discussion. I don't think Jackie was saying it was wrong. I don't think Jackie was saying that this is the way it should be. I think Jackie's saying this is what it is right now. That's the part. That's when you sign that contract. That's what it is.
We've had that convo, but it's more so in regards to soccer and the verbiage used in that.
Problematic so, shit. Yeah. I'm gonna buy and sell this guy. I'm gonna do, and it's like, dog, like that. Did you just rub me the wrong way?
And we're even talking about kids here. Like, it's not like. Like, they're transferring, like, 12 and 14 and 8-year-olds. 8-year-olds are signing with clubs and stuff. So, I get what you're saying.
I'm upset.
Ryan has a counterpoint.
Be careful.
I'm Jewish. I identify as such. So, out of context, and even within context, what Jackie Mack said was problematic. Super micro racism there, but she probably didn't realize it when she said it, and she'll probably, what am I saying, she'll definitely learn from it. But if you take it in context, I think what Kyrie was talking about was that we all know the way he feels. We all know how supportive he's been of a lot of things, Black Lives Matter. He didn't play in the bubble, but he was, you know, he was a face, he was out there, he was getting stuff done. I think the point is Kyrie seems to have issues with a lot of things, and they're not really targeted issues in that he doesn't know which issue he wants to confront. He just has an issue with a lot of things. And I think what Jackie Mack was trying to say is with the poor verbiage, is you're an employee of this basketball team, and that is why they pay you ridiculous amounts of money, is to go and play. That is any job, and if you don't like it, quit. That's any job. If you don't like your job, you know what you have the option to do is quit. And while I understand that the verbiage is problematic, his issue is that he feels lesser than the people at the top. Fully understood. But you have the option to say, I'm done with this game. I want to go take a different direction in life. And that's fine. But what he's doing is waffling wherever the fuck he is, clearly not getting the pandemic, and then complaining a lot and not really doing anything about it or talking to anybody about it. Like, I don't know. Like,
He's not telling us that he's talking to people.
I understand.
We don't know
where Jackie is coming from. The words were incorrect, but I understand what she is trying to tell him is you are an employee. You get paid millions and millions and millions of dollars to show up. So please show up or quit.
Kyrie feels like an angry teenager that doesn't know what to do with it. It's just all over the place. One of my favorite quotes that I use for a lot of people is that it's in the James Bond movie, of all things, is you're a kite in a hurricane, Mr. Bond. Like, that's what I feel about Kyrie. He's got all this misplaced anger and just he knows things are fucked up. He wants to do something. There's a part of me that wants to reach out to him and be like, dude, I understand. Like, I'm frustrated and fucked up about a lot of shit, too. I understand, like, what it is that you have to bear with as far as being an NBA player, as far as being a role model, as far as having all the money, as far as having knowing that you can make a difference. That's got to weigh on you hard. But you got to grow up. There's a certain element of you that needs to hold yourself accountable to, okay, I need to figure out and put a plan together and talk to the right people so that I can funnel this into the correct ways instead of just all over the fucking place.
I mean, I feel like what he has is he's paralyzed by the amount of things that he sees wrong and he can't figure out where to start, so he just doesn't. And trust me, I understand that feeling.
I do too.
But if you can't do it, he's got all the money in the world. There's something he wants to fix. He can find a group or some people that have way more knowledge than him and be like, hey, let's team up. Let's go fix this.
See, that's the part that Kyrie is like. Kyrie reminds me of like my nephew, which is that you got somebody who has a lot of energy and you know if we can funnel it in the right place, it's going to be for good. But a case in point in a microcosm is what happened in the bubble. You had Kyrie, who wasn't even going to play in the bubble, complaining and saying that maybe we shouldn't play. You had guys like LeBron who said, okay, we might have an issue with this. And after time, what they did was call Barack Obama at 2 o'clock in the morning and say, we need guidance. I need guidance. Kyrie, to me, still feels like the guy who thinks he has it figured out, but he still's got a lot to learn. You can't be a great leader until you follow the right people. You have to follow the right people to become a good leader. That's what you have to figure out. So LeBron, there are tons of times where I'm like, LeBron, you're not as informed as you need to be on it. But you know what LeBron does a lot of time? Take a step back. He won't talk for a sec. Then you see behind the scenes, he's doing X, Y, and Z. That's how I'm tackling this issue.
Even if it's not Kyrie's the right way to tackle it, he right. had a plan.
Kyrie's just needs somebody to pull him to the side and say, yuck, man, I understand that you're angry. I understand all this shit. We just got to figure out how to actually turn that into actionable shit.
And here's my biggest issue. And I have no basis. I have no knowledge on this, except for the fact that Kyrie's a superstar. I'm sure people have tried. It's just because the level he's at, there are people that have tried, I'm sure. And my issue is, it seems like he's not taking... He's not
that goes
taking
to,
anything in.
That goes to Stephen A. Smith's comment in response to Kyrie's statement that he made earlier this season, calling the reporters peons and stuff like that. So,
yeah, look, the way Jackie Max said what she said was very problematic, but what she said was not. She's been around the league for 40 years. She's seen how it works. She probably knows people who could probably go talk to Kyrie if he wanted to listen. My issue is, it doesn't really look like he wants to listen. He wants to talk. And that, you can't learn anything unless you surround yourself with good people. Self-awareness is key. Kyrie lacks it.
Well, that's my thing, is that you look at all the old heads in basketball or otherwise, the way that they talk about Kyrie is almost like, you can tell he's never leaned on them. Now, maybe it's on them that they need to reach out to him. But the way that, like, I hear a lot of some of the old NBA players, or like if I'm watching Inside the NBA or anything, and the way that they're talking about, like, Kyrie needs to basically shit to get off the pod. I get a vibe that maybe he's not doing the things that he needs to do.
But you tell me Shaq and Chuck haven't tried to reach out? Like,
maybe not. I don't know.
LeBron, anybody who has any semblance that Kyrie he could be such a face and a voice for whatever it is we're trying to do, and whatever, because he doesn't have a problem with talking. He could be so great at leading a movement or leading for change, but he just doesn't want to be involved with anybody else.
I had to make sure. Like, you know who Rod Strickland is, right?
Yep.
You know that's Kyrie's godfather. So, like, he does look up to people. Like, so I'm sure he has a relationship with him. So,
I honestly hope.
No, I'm saying there's, if you look up Kyrie Irving, Ross Strickland, there's a bunch of different articles discussing their relationship. They do have a relationship.
I don't know where Rod Strickland fits in as far as from being knowledgeable about X, Y, and Z.
Yeah, I don't know either, but
right. But I'm saying, like, when
he played.
Here's my thing, is that when you have, case in point, LeBron in Cleveland with Kyrie, and Kyrie has an opportunity to learn from LeBron, we saw what happened.
Mm-hmm. He wanted to be my own guy.
I want to be my own man. That's how I imagine he said it.
I don't blame him for that.
There's certain aspects basketball-wise where Kyrie was supposed to be the guy, LeBron waffling around decides to come back to Cleveland. They're problematic. But waffling? You won a chip.
Wait, what do you mean waffling?
When LeBron left Cleveland to go to South Beach, LeBron's done with South Beach and decides he wants to go anywhere he wants to go. Mm-hmm. They got Kyrie based out of the vacuum LeBron left in Cleveland. Mm-hmm. Kyrie was supposed to be that guy in Cleveland. It was his squad. Mm-hmm. LeBron then decides, because LeBron is LeBron and he could do whatever he wants, I'm going to grace Cleveland back again with my presence. So he goes back to Cleveland. Kyrie's like, well, I thought I was supposed to be the guy now. He gets pushed off to the wayside again because it's LeBron's team. He feels a certain way. I look at that differently.
Like, in terms of LeBron's reasoning for going back to Cleveland, from my understanding, it was, I won in South Beach, but I need to do it in Cleveland. So it wasn't like, yeah, I'm gonna come back to Cleveland because, like, I feel like gracing y'all with my presence. I didn't feel it was like that.
It was like that because LeBron had to leave to go get a championship. And once he got enough under his belt to say that I won a championship, now I can go waffle around in Cleveland again because I already won mine.
Nah, it was more so like I felt like he had to go somewhere else to learn how to win it, like in a organization that was
right. Put Dwayne Wade and Chris Bosh on your team.
Yeah. And then he figured out how to win it.
That was such a dirty fucking squad.
And Kyrie was very integral in that entire run. But
yeah,
I'm saying from Kyrie's perspective, not LeBron's perspective.
Okay.
Kyrie's perspective of, I thought this is the dude that put on a national televisionized thing to tell you that he wasn't coming back. I'm supposed to be the guy now. Now he's coming back? What the fuck? Mm-hmm. I'm talking about from Kyrie's standpoint. I can understand being upset if I'm Kyrie, but you won a championship.
Yeah, I wouldn't have been upset. I'm like, all right, cool. Like, now we can win because we weren't winning before.
That is that, and that I think is the issue with Kyrie, is he doesn't see the good. He's only, I feel hard done by this, so I'm going to hold on to it forever. Maybe that's why he doesn't want to take guidance from anybody. He just
Let's move on to
screw him.
As another serious topic, or a more serious topic, Kat announced that he had COVID. Well, he has COVID. It's a very touchy subject for him, just based on the fact of how many family members he's lost in the past year from COVID, including his mother. So, yeah, prayers up to you, Kat.
Yeah. I mean, and he's already dealing with just the worst injury too. It has not been a good 12 months for Karl Anthony Towns.
At all.
So. But I think we need to start firing that conversation back up on whether or not we should be playing anything.
Yeah, especially like not without a bubble. And if you look at it, every week there's games postponed. I'm dumb enough to do fantasy basketball this year, and like I've already had like 6 or 7 games postponed that I had players that were playing. I mean, it's selfish and stupid on my part, so whatever. Like, I get it. But at the same time, like, that goes to another reason, saying, like, are you sure we should be playing? If not, like, if we are supposed to play, then why aren't we in a bubble atmosphere?
Because that's the thing, is that right now we're at a particular point in time where I think the American people overall have now stomached an appetite for this and are okay. As fucked up as it is, I think we're okay.
Isn't that crazy? Because you remember when, like, when Rudy Gobert caught COVID, and then the whole fucking league shut down.
March 11th, I'll never forget that day.
Yeah, ESPN had like a memory like video about it, and like my favorite part was like looking at Mark Cuban on the sideline of the Mavs game, going like this to his phone, and like showing the person next to him, like, can you believe this shit?
Right, and it was what March Madness getting canceled and everything, and then Tom Hanks that same day, and it was
like, all right, Rudy Gerber has COVID. The NBA is going to cancel everything after this game, and then he's like, oh shit, and then now you got
quadruple the deaths plus,
and players like every week, like, oh yeah, they're in quarantine, like they're doing contact tracing. This person has COVID. And it's like, oh, yep. Like, they'll come back in 10 days and everything will be okay. And I'm like, this is weird.
We as a country are entirely too comfortable with getting comfortable with shit that we shouldn't be. It's the same reason you could have Donald Trump in the White House.
Blame the internet.
On any day, on any given day, for any other administration throughout the history of time, if they had done 1/10 of what he did, would be the biggest story. We wouldn't have ever had anything to do with it. They would have tried to get his ass up out of office immediately. Can you imagine Barack Obama doing anything Donald Trump has done? And yet we sit there and it's like, oh, it's just a crazy thing he did today.
No, but
that's what it is.
It's not even just Trump anymore. It's everybody.
Right. It's what I'm saying. But I was just using Trump as an example. But we hit 4,000 deaths a day, which is the number that I kept waiting for, that maybe it'll be enough to get people to stop. No. Not at all.
No, I mean, it's once the number gets so large, people just get used to it. That's sad.
Or the next big story.
Yeah.
Like, we got the same day that somebody, we might be 3,800 deaths, but no, we want to talk about some stupid shit on Twitter again.
Yeah, we want to talk about Kim Kardashian's like new skin routine.
We want to talk about Kanye West fucking Jeffree Star more than we want to talk about the amount of people that have just died from goddamn COVID.
Yep.
I'm in the next batch of vaccinations.
So people good. Don't care about the truth when the lie is more entertaining.
How much you pay to skip up in the line, Brian?
I'm an essential worker because I'm an attorney.
No.
I'm in 1C. It's the same one that the 70-year-olds are in.
My fat ass is going to catch COVID because I'm going to be that far down the goddamn rung of list to get the goddamn vaccine thing, Rima.
Yeah. All right. So...
I mean,
like your resignation.
No. I was gonna like expound on my point when I was like, I mean, but I just said fuck it. Like, let's just move on. So I was like, all right, yeah.
yeah.
So now let's get into the football part of this pod. At first I was at a 2, but now I'm on 10. Do you know who said that famous quote this week?
I know who, Deshaun Watson.
Yeah. He tweeted it.
He did.
Yeah. Like, at first, that was the report when they were talking about how angry Deshaun Watson was when they traded DeAndre Hopkins compared to when they hired the Patriots dude to be their
Nick Caserio. Yeah.
Right. And then it was like, yeah, at first, Deshaun Watson was at a 2, but now he's at a 10. And then he just tweeted it. And then he also tweeted some future lyrics, I believe. And then in one of the bars of the song, it said, fuck Houston, I'm going to Chicago.
I think somebody read way too far into that.
If you post that song, I'm going to look at the lyrics. And you look at the lyrics, that line is in there.
Plus, Deshaun's throwing shade. So it's not, I don't think it's far removed.
Not just Deshaun, but everybody. Doing. Right. Everybody's throwing shade.
Right.
Even the players right on the team.
But here's the thing. He's got every right to be pissed off because he is the anti-James Harden. He is the guy who the organization has done everything in their power to fuck him over. And he still stayed loyal.
Yep.
And they're wasting his best years. He's coming up. He's not even in his prime yet. He's about to hit the prime. And they're doing everything they can to hamstring this guy. Well, you got J.J. Watt, who's the biggest leader in that locker room, since Andre Johnson. I mean, if you're talking about a Mount Rushmore of the Houston Texans, right now there's probably – I think Deshaun might even be on that already. But you definitely have Andre Johnson. You got J.J. Watt. Maybe Arian Foster. I don't know. But you got – but you're talking about
– not maybe not yet. The way that he left and what he's doing now.
Yeah, Arian Foster's a little – I'm trying to think about who the other guys would be. They might not have enough.
He said he can beat a wolf too, so I respect it.
But
confidence is key.
When you got JJ that you hear on a hot mic, we wasted your year, bro. Mm-hmm. Like I'm sorry,
apologizing.
I'm sorry, we wasted it. JJ knows what's up. Deshaun knows what's up. And then when you got a dude that's basically saying like, "Hey, I don't need to make final decisions. I just want to be heard." And they do everything in their power to make sure, yeah, we don't give a fuck. Coming after you had the comments that the previous owner made about the inmates running the asylum.
He didn't say asylum. He said prison.
Prison. Fuck out of here.
Yep.
Now, I even said in the last pod that Houston has a small window to try to do right by him. And it still seems like it's gone too far.
No, the window's shut.
It's shut.
Like even...
it's gonna get ugly though.
Next point,
it's gonna get ugly.
Hmm? Ryan, you wanted to say anything else about it? All right, this transition to my next point: what the Houston Texans did when they threw like, they were like, "Yeah, Deshaun Watson's mad at y'all." So then they threw a little request out there to interview Eric Bieniemy, like after the fact. And yeah, I don't think Eric Bieniemy is gonna get a job. Just nuts. They're even talking about like doing the QB coach, like I said last week. So,
man, or he can just stay in Kansas City and win like four more Super Bowls.
Yeah, but Ryan, it's like let's say at your job, right? You're the best lawyer in the area, and there are positions of partnership opening up all around you, and yet they're hiring like one of the people that you manage. They're talking about hiring them for partner when it could have been you. You would be pissed.
I'd be pissed, but I got okay. Maybe I got a problematic past. I bet you he ends up a head coach somewhere. I'd be hard pressed.
I'm telling you, man. Like everybody that's getting hired has problematic passes.
There's still four coach openings, right?
Like who? Because Atlanta just hired the Titans offensive coordinator.
Right.
The Titans offensive coordinator over the Chiefs? That's nuts.
Philly?
Chiefs are still Philly playing.
Yeah, but...
They can't hire him right now.
I know, they can't, but why would you hire... All right, never mind. I don't believe in him, but whatever. You got the Falcons just hired somebody. The Jets hired somebody. Who else?
Are y'all hearing a popping sound? This is just me.
Damn it.
It's always you. It's always your phone.
Just look, when you hear it, just say, James, move your phone.
I was trying to figure out if it was something on my end because it sounded a little different this time.
No, it's James.
All right. So you said the Eagles are still open?
Yeah.
Who else is still open?
Chargers. I lost track after some of these no-name motherfuckers got jobs.
The Chargers... They're interviewing somebody and they said that he's most likely gonna get it. The Bills offensive coordinator, I believe, is supposed to go to the Chargers.
Can't Urban hire him, Myers right? in Jacksonville.
Yep.
Robert Salah just got
didn't Anthony Lynn come from Buffalo too? So they're hiring two Buffalo Bills coordinators in a row.
They can't They can't hire anybody yet.
I know, but they're saying like he's going to be the one once the Bills lose.
Look, I'll wait until this is all said and done, because a lot of the stars in terms of coaching, they're still playing. They're still in the playoffs. So
yep.
Look, what I said last episode about Eric Bieniemy, and meaning that, look, I didn't mean to dredge up his past as a legitimate reason why somebody can't hire him. I think that if you're looking around the league, there are a lot of dudes that are getting opportunities that he deserves one. That I find it hard to believe that they wouldn't just give this guy a shot. If I'm going over Bieniemy's entire history of coaching or anything, there's nothing that blows me away necessarily, but that just goes to also show there's a lot of guys that get hired that don't blow me away. I don't understand why they're getting the opportunity over him. It's not that it's like some slam dunk. If you gave me Urban Meyer or Eric Bieniemy to hire, I'm hiring Urban Meyer. But there's a lot of other guys that I'm like, why you?
I wouldn't hire Urban Meyer over Bieniemy.
I would, but that's me knowing that what I've seen Urban Meyer do as far as completely change the culture of certain programs.
To me, that's all different, because you're talking about, like, you change everything out every 4 years.
There's a difference between the way that you also run the team as far as this. Look, there's a difference, in my opinion, between an Urban Meyer and a Steve Spurrier. There's a difference between an Urban Meyer and a Nick Saban, even. There's a Pete Carroll type of mold that I believe in, even though he makes some very questionable calls as far as just team building. I think Urban Meyer, as far as if I'm looking across the entire coaching landscape, I don't think there's a guy that's more prepared to do the job. I put him above Cliff Kingsbury. I put him above Lincoln Riley. I put him above a lot of other guys. But that's what I'm saying, is it's somebody with that kind of pedigree in which I'm saying, okay, slam dunk. But there are a lot of other dudes I'm like, I don't know the offense coordinator from fucking Tennessee's name. I look at that and say, all right, he turned shit into gold as far as Ryan Tannehill and Derrick Henry and everything. That if you're looking at the offenses, Eric Bieniemy having Patrick Mahomes as the best quarterback in the league, running games that go crazy, having Tyreek Hill, that maybe it's the talent that does it. I don't know.
I think maybe the only knock that we're not really talking about is it Bieniemy or is it the talent that he has?
But you remember, I was looking up like people discussing the Urban Meyer to Jacksonville thing. And
I gotta sneeze. Sorry.
Right, I'll talk while you sneeze. All right. So one of the parts that they brought up was, okay, everybody's like excited about the hire if you're just looking at X's and O's, right? But then you also gotta remember that he retired twice for health concerns. Also, he got in hot water for the sexual assault allegations that happened at Ohio State. Where like he failed to report somebody's accusations to him about like somebody on his staff. So it's, yeah, I'm tired of people getting looked over.
I mean, Urban Meyer is a better fit in Jacksonville than Bieniemy is. I don't think that can be argued.
I don't want to compare Urban Meyer to Bieniemy. What I do want to compare is there is under no circumstances, regardless of whatever your criteria is, whether it be the talent around you or anything, that Adam Gase should have gotten a head coaching position over Eric Bieniemy.
Yeah.
Wait, where's Adam Gase?
Unemployed, but he had how many opportunities and how many shots?
Oh, yeah. No, I see what you're saying. Sorry. I was like, did somebody hire him? Because now I got to hate that team more than any other team now. No, here's the thing. I think you're going to see – once the Chiefs lose to the Bills, I think you're going to see that a lot of teams are going after Bieniemy. I think he should get it, but one more year in Kansas City is not necessarily the worst thing in the world for him either. There are going to be tons of coaching positions opening him up next year as well.
You can look at the silver lining. The silver lining would be Bieniemy, go winning some more championships so you can demand more when you decide to be a head coach.
I haven't heard Bieniemy say anything yet. So,
because he's focused on the playoffs.
Right. Maybe he doesn't interview well because he's focused on the playoffs. I don't know. Like, he's.
Or that could be some bullshit that people put out there.
Let's let this season play out and see where he ends up. Because if he wins five Super Bowls with Kansas City, And then, you know, moves on for a head coaching position where he's making $30 million a year. Like, great for him. Like, I don't know what he wants either. So I understand. Yeah. Maybe there are some head coaching places that he should go. I think Chargers is a great place for him to be, but I also don't know if he wants to be doing that, to be honest. So Some coaches just want to fucking win. And I get that.
So the Lions, the Texans, the Chargers, and the Eagles are left.
All great. I can say all those be great landing spots for him.
If he goes to Philly, which could be a discussion considering Andy Reid came from Philly.
And also he's got another mobile quarterback, mobile tight ends.
Yeah.
But very good running back in Miles Sanders.
Then he can trade.
No offensive line.
You can trade Carson Wentz to the Colts like everybody else thinks that he should and get some draft capital.
I don't think Carson Wentz is going anywhere. But that's fair.
I mean, depends on if you believe in Jalen Hurts or not.
I mean, you could also just Taysom Hill Jalen Hurts for a little bit. He's on his second year.
I wouldn't do that. Just based on the fact that, like, if you're doing that, you're wasting the rookie QB years that are valuable. In my opinion.
I mean, but you're already paying Wentz $40 million a year, so you're not gonna have him sit on the bench. That's what I'm saying.
That's why I'm saying you move him.
But based on his performance this year, I don't know who's gonna pick that contract up.
The Colts.
I don't think they'll pay that.
I said the Colts are waiting to see what Philip Rivers decided to do.
Yeah, Philip might be done, and he might go to.
He had an insanely good.
He might be in the booth.
He had an insanely good year though. Carson Wentz did not.
Although at the end that Hail Mary was sad.
Well, he throws like this.
I'm just saying he used to have arguably the strongest arm in the NFL. It's fell off. The Philip Rivers right now.
He just talks.
Philip Rivers right now, I think Indianapolis is looking at either he's coming back or he's retiring and then they figure out the next. But I don't know if they'll mortgage all that future on Carson Wentz right now. I think the Carson Wentz deal has been about Philadelphia realizing that Carson Wentz doesn't even want to be there anymore. He might be a problem in that locker room
Frank Reich used to be his coach, though.
I know. It makes sense. Like, I think I was the one that brought up Indianapolis first as far as being the best option for Carson Wentz because of the Frank Reich connection. But
after his injury, he changed his throwing motion, and he just looks like trash.
Carson Wentz has he is Tom Brady's mentality as far as anytime he hears footsteps around him, he freaks the fuck out. If there's anyone that's even sniffing at the job that he has, he folds. It's the same reason that Tom made sure that they ran off any fucking quarterback that was worth a grain of salt in New England, which is why they're in this shitty situation that they're in, because he just didn't want to feel as though there were any footsteps around him. There's nobody that should be able to challenge my throne. Carson Wentz doesn't have anywhere near the pedigree that Tom Brady has, but he still has that kind of mentality.
What did the Niners give the Patriots for Garoppolo?
Fourth round.
Yeah, I forget what the pick was.
I thought it was first round pick.
I don't think Jimmy G was a first rounder, but
I'm going to look it up now.
But even with the Jimmy G thing, what, his contract's about to be up.
And there's talks about the Texans trading for him.
Second round pick.
Yeah. So, I mean, if a team's going to give you a second round pick for your backup QB and you still have Tom Brady, I'd do it too.
I'm saying even San Francisco could put together a Jimmy G and a few draft picks to try to get the Houston and get Deshaun.
That's what I'm saying. Like,
ooh, I would hate that.
George Kittle posted a photo of Deshaun Watson, a 49ers jersey, and Deshaun Watson commented. It's like, that's what happens, like, at this time, point in time. All
speculation.
No, it's like,
with Kyle Shanahan would be.
It's every team at this point in time.
Yeah, I mean,
like, except for those chosen few.
You're like I've been saying, if you're in the league, other than maybe five teams, I think you had it at seven last week.
But what I'm saying is, like, it's not the front office doing it. It's the fans. The fans always do that shit.
I think the front offices are doing it too. I just don't think they can't. It's tampering if they put out a tweet.
Yeah, everybody like thinking like, all right, if we had Deshaun Watson, that would look good. Of course.
Of course. Yeah, every team should think that.
We're not going to argue that one. All right. So, one last thing before we get into our picks to see if we want to change anything. News came out this week that Mark Davis bought the Las Vegas Aces. I'm not sure if he's the shit. I was supposed to look that up. I'm not sure if he's the only NFL owner that also owns like a WNBA team. But yeah, I thought it was a great move. Another article about like a beat writer, Jerry McDonald, who covers the Raiders, was discussing about how he was at a Las Vegas Aces game like a while ago. And Jerry's wife went down there to talk to Mark because they know each other. And then they had a nice little conversation, like he was sitting courtside and stuff. And then at the end of the conversation, he was asking, all right, so how do I buy one of these teams? Because he was sitting there, he was like, oh, this is nice. But then that also goes to the show, like, that brought up a whole nother discussion in regards to, yeah, like, everybody talks shit about Mark Davis in terms of being broke. Right? K-Dot, you've done that yourself on this pod.
He's the brokest NFL owner.
Yeah, but, like, he's bought a WNBA team. But at the same
time, how much did that cost
him? I don't know. The details haven't come out yet. But somebody...
$3,000 investment, I could get with it. I'm joking.
Don't disrespect the
WNBA. I'm joking. Jeez.
Like, come on, man. That's problematic as fuck.
I like the I'm a WNBA defender. Right. Ted Leo sits there and Washington owns everything.
But what I'm saying is, like, people that don't know you only hear that part.
If anyone's going through our podcast to clip that part out for me, I've made it.
You know we're going to get, like, 5 clips in the Twitter group chat, like, by next week. Especially people trying to debate Ryan on Steph Curry not being a superstar, which is hilarious. All right.
Well, it's a good move as far as the WNBA. Anybody taking ownership of these teams or anyone that can take ownership of these teams or it even makes the news that they're taking ownership of these teams is only good for the WNBA as far as bringing things in there. I just hope he runs it better than his football team.
Yeah.
You can't even find a list of owners at the WNBA.
There's a lot of crossover for NBA owners that own WNBA teams, if I'm not mistaken. I know in Washington that's the case because Leonsis owns the Caps, the Wiz, and the Mystics. Right?
Does he own the arena?
I think he has an arena stake, too.
I almost put my phone next to the mic.
Yeah, again. I heard it.
We heard it.
Really?
Yeah.
Are you serious?
Yes. Yes. Yeah,
immediately. Now, yeah. See, it's you. It's me trying to scramble around before we did the pod last time, turning off fans in the fucking weed tent. Like, I'm not to make sure I'm not a distraction. It's your goddamn phone.
My bad.
Aren't you on a Mac?
5G. No. I got an HP.
Oh.
The 5G, fucking up our podcast and giving James COVID.
Don't wish that. Like, that. The fuck, man.
Weren't you the one to watch Plandemic or some shit?
I feel like we all had to watch it.
I did not watch that goddamn movie.
I did not watch that shit.
I started it. Oh. I couldn't finish it.
Yeah. Like, somebody said it to me. I was like, all right. Like, I don't know shit about shit. You don't know shit about shit, so...
I'm definitely not watching something called Plandemic.
It's the Kyrie of documentaries.
Oh, did you guys see Kyrie's new Twitter handle? World Be Flat. Ah! Oh. The takeoff on World Be Free.
All right. So, props to Mark Davis for buying the Aces.
Yeah, props.
I'm proud of him for it.
Not going to watch it.
All right. Yeah. All right. So let's go back to our NFL picks and right. Yeah, never mind. WNBA is not as bad as you make it seem right now. So
I just don't enjoy it.
Okay. You should play against them.
Dude, Deladon, I'd play 21 against her for
Alyssa Thomas gave me the meanest Euro step in my life.
Deladon could dunk over me as many times as she wanted.
Oh, yeah, you do like it. Okay, never mind. All right, mm-hmm. I, yeah, all right.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, you're getting off on that. All right. So, there's only four games this weekend.
Mm-hmm.
So,
although I will say the NFL, the new playoff thing, this should be it. Having six games wildcard weekend with fucking bananas. It's
especially
amazing.
Especially if we could go outside. Especially if we can all be in the bar. Oh my
God. Oh no.
God, man, can you imagine?
Just a full
weekend of debauchery.
You just sit, you just sit in your spot and you but you spend so much
I got one of the my dad and I got one of the inflatable outdoor projectors.
Oh, yeah.
Well, see, this is why I also, as my
this time
phone
next
keeps going
year,
off. Oh, sorry, go ahead.
Oh, this time next year, we're going to be sitting in lawn chairs watching this on a 400-inch projection screen getting hammered.
That sounds amazing. I was going to say, as far as spending a lot of money, that's why all of my clients are bars in D.C., and they're about to reopen, so I'm just saying.
Let's go.
Congratulations, sir.
The vaccine rollout in D.C. has been awesome, so they're going to be opening up much quicker.
Kata, did you get in contact with my cousin?
Yeah, we had a full blown conversation.
Okay, cool.
Was dope. She was really dope.
I just keep forgetting.
No, we had a full blown conversation. She has my info, and we're probably gonna collaborate and work doing some stuff together going forward.
Nice. All right. So, first game, Packers Rams. We all picked the Packers. Is anybody changing? Cool.
Are we doing scores like we did last week?
Yeah, no. Let's do that.
We were so bad, but okay.
Do you want? I'm asking. I don't. Either way, it's a toss-up.
This pod is running too long anyway.
Okay.
All right.
Ravens Bills. I'm the only one who picked the Ravens. Okay, yeah,
that was hard, but I still think the Bills are the best team in the playoffs.
I think they're the best overall. Anytime team. I think about picking the Bills, and I bet Keem that the Bills would win. Which is funny, but anytime I think about picking the Bills, I just remember Lamar shaking Milano out of his boots when he was like, "Yeah, I think we could contain Lamar Jackson," and then like, "Wait, is this you?"
There is one thing I wanted to take a look at was whether or not it actually is going to.
It's not.
But no snow, but wind.
Oh, that what does that do? Like, there's wind in Baltimore too.
No,
not lakefront.
Not like Buffalo.
Buffalo win.
Does Lamar throw the ball like down the field like the whole game? No.
Can he throw it at all?
He can run though. That's not changing.
Yeah, but the Buffalo's look, I think that game could go either way.
Me too.
Buffalo's just gonna stack the box and make Lamar throw on them.
But that is why. That is exactly why I picked the Ravens to win here, and then I bet Keem that the Buffalo would win.
But see, the thing that's being underrated about Buffalo is about Baltimore is their defense. Their defense has been, and it's gotten better as far as against the run and against the pass. They're not going to be something to sniff at. I don't know. Going into this, I just thought Buffalo was the absolute best. I didn't like Buffalo last week. I thought that they were going to play better than they did. But
Josh Allen's got the playoff win under his belt. He's good.
So does Lamar.
Yeah, but one of these is an actual quarterback. The other one's a glorified running back.
Not doing that. All right.
Yeah, that's bullshit.
That is
problematic bullshit.
It was
No, it's not. It is.
The year before Vic went away for Bad News Kennels, when Jim Moore Jr. put together finally the offense that Vic, his passing rate was like top in the league, where it was finally like, holy shit, he did it. Vic became the scariest player I've ever seen in the history of the NFL. And I don't say that with hyperbole. He became the absolute scariest player I've ever seen in the NFL. I think Lamar's passing ability is better than Vic.
Yeah.
I just haven't seen him completely put it together. But when he does,
he's not a glorified running back. He could just run really well.
Okay. Lamar Jackson threw for 2,700 yards this year.
That's right.
Josh Allen threw for 4,550.
Nobody's arguing that Josh Allen's not a better like passer of the ball. Nobody's stupid enough to say that.
You know, you know what I will say? I prefer Josh Allen's running style to Lamar's. I'm not saying he's better. I prefer it. You know who Josh Allen reminds me of? Elway. The closest thing I can think of is Elway. because Elway would get out of the pocket and start moving around or anything, but you could tell he didn't. Sometimes you could tell Elway just wanted to hit somebody. Like, it wasn't that he was expecting. No, he puts his shoulder down. He's like, I'm going to take somebody out.
Yeah, like.
Allen does the same thing.
He's not going to get, like, Allen's not going to take the big hits.
Oh, no, he'll dish him out, though.
Yeah, yeah. I like Josh Allen, too. But for some reason.
I don't hate your Ravens.
I don't know who's going to win. So, I don't know. All right. Next game, Browns and Chiefs. I am the only one who picked the Browns. Ooh. Nobody's changing?
No, it's the fucking Chiefs. The Browns, if they win this, they're going to win the Super Bowl.
I'm going to change my pick.
I figured.
You're going Browns.
Yeah, like people are really overestimating the Chiefs and underestimating the Browns.
I like Baker Mayfield too much.
Baker Mayfield's my favorite quarterback.
Really?
I've said this time and time again. I like a guy who actually grinds from the bottom and wasn't handed anything, and Baker never got handed anything.
Yeah.
That's why I love that mentality. I've always been a Baker defender. I love Baker Mayfield. And after what he said about Colin Lamar Cowherd, Jackson,
How do you feel about Lamar Jackson?
I love Lamar too. And I love especially what Lamar does for the city. But as far as guys that I look at that mentality, I'm like, this is a dude who I'm going to follow and root for the rest of his career is Baker. And,
I like when he flipped the capper back around. That was funny.
Baker's not the reason that anybody's going to pick the Browns this week. It's Kareem Hunt and Nick Chubb. And it's Kareem Hunt is angry. Understood. Nick Chubb is just a fucking monster. Understood. And if they get that running game going, there's not to say that both of them could have 120 yards on the ground and get it rolling. And if that's the case, night Chiefs.
Control the clock. Keep the Chiefs offense off the field. Also, I saw some really good, really bad Pittsburgh offensive play, but some really good Browns defensive play last week. Mm-hmm. So
my thing is Pittsburgh was the worst team in the playoffs. And I'm not giving
– Oh, they're awful.
They were the worst team in the playoffs. And you can thank the Washington football team for breaking them. You're welcome. but it's – I don't know. If Cleveland wins this game, to me, it's just they're a team of destiny because they had no reason to be in it anyway. They shouldn't have won last week, even against the worst team in the playoffs, just because of what they had to go through the
coaching. Not only did they win, they won by a fuck ton.
Yeah.
Yeah, give me the Browns.
I'm sticking with my Chiefs.
All right. I'll check that later. All right, so.
James is either going to be a fucking genius this week or he's going to be me from last week.
Oh, shit, you're right. Damn.
Yeah, you're out here on a limb, huh?
Nah, like, we all picked the Packers. I'm on the limb with the Ravens. You're on the limb with the Chiefs.
Which is insane to me, but okay. But that's only because he switched. But I got – all right, got it. All right, Bucks.
No, you know what? You're right. Because looking at the last pick, I picked the Saints, and y'all both picked the Bucks.
And Ryan can't change another one.
I was –
not changing?
No, I – oh, I can't.
No. K-Dot, you're not changing?
No.
Okay.
Tom Brady. It's Tom Brady in the playoffs. Not rooting against him.
Huh? He's lost in the playoffs before.
He has, but not me picking
him. Well, this time, too.
Okay, fine. So if we're going to go off that, if you're a betting man, you can either bet against Tom Brady or for Tom Brady. Let me know over the history which is giving you more money.
I don't really bet on
just
it.
Saying, so. I get what you're just
hypothetically, saying. Hypothetically, God damn it.
All right. Hypothetically, Brady is one more.
Also, Brady has more weapons on offense than he ever has in his entire career.
Mm-hmm. And it's the first time he's with the Bucks, so we'll see.
And he's got one receiver who's playing super angry. So.
And Washington's defense is better than New Orleans.
Who's super angry?
Antonio.
Why?
I don't think Antonio's angry.
Yeah. Oh, I said he's playing angry.
I don't think he's playing angry either. I think he's having a lot of fun.
He scored a touchdown.
I think
he's having fun.
He's playing happy because he gets to play.
Touchdowns and then he just yells. I like it. And he's breaking tackles wide the fuck open at 45
I'm getting flashbacks.
Or whatever.
Can we talk about something else?
Yeah. hopefully, Mike Evans is good though. I know he's been hurt these past couple weeks. So
also, Godwin played like shit last week, and I'm hoping he bounces.
Lest we forget. Yeah. Gronk is still on that team.
He's a glorified blocking tight end, apparently.
He could get
according to him.
He could get out. He's got those soft hands.
So. He is. But here's the thing. That blocking tight end is the best goddamn blocking tight end in the history of the NFL. So
that's why he's so hurt.
Name a blocking tight end. Name a tight end that blocked better than
Rob Gronkowski.
In the history of the NFL, you think George Kittle is a better blocking tight end than Rob Gronkowski?
Yeah.
I think you're ridiculous.
Okay.
I think that is absolutely ridiculous. I think George Kittle maybe has the tools to do it over a sustained period of time. But okay. There was nobody – Rob Gronkowski's
– Okay.
There was never anybody like him. 260 pounds, 666.
We can review this next week.
And that's why Gronkowski got so open all the time. It's because they thought he was just blocking. And they put two guys on him, and then he'd slip out.
Okay.
I'm not saying he's the best receiving tight end of all time.
I didn't say that either.
He's a tumbly-bumbly guy.
All right, so final thoughts. My final thought is congratulations to Wayne Rooney on his career. He just officially retired, and he's going to be the manager of Derby.
Yeah, he's been the player manager for Derby for the last two seasons.
Yeah,
and now he's just going to hanging up the boots, and he's just going to be a manager. So, yeah, congratulations to him. Still one of my favorite DC United moments was when he tackled the – left wing
with no goalie in the net,
and then
need to score.
Whipped it back in,
crossed it,
header
from half court.
It's wonderful. My final thoughts, brief. Caps are back. They're 2-0. Zdeno Chara is still the largest man in the history of the NHL.
Mm-hmm.
I'm glad him and Tom Wilson are not fighting anymore. Ovi hasn't scored a goal yet, which is weird, but he'll get to 50 somehow.
Yeah.
I don't know. I really like the back-to-back games, though. So we played back-to-back against Buffalo because they're trying to keep them, I guess, kind of bubbled. So they're playing only in conference and they're playing back-to-back games so that they have more testing in between before they go somewhere else.
Okay.
Oh, my God. Look, the NHL is doing something right again.
Mm-hmm.
Like, remember the bubble, which they had done? Which other people did, and it worked. It's great. Look at them.
NBA, learn some. All right, K-Dot, you go.
I want to commemorate this being either the last or at least second to last pod of the Donald Trump presidency, which is something that makes me very, very happy. I will also say, being here, that I'm in D.C. for the next week. It won't just be D.C. I need everyone to be as vigilant as they possibly can be. These crazy radicalized domestic terrorists around this country who we have been, especially Black people and Jews, have been talking about how they've put together their militias and bullshit. We've seen an escalation of which we've never seen before. You talk about earlier this year, they wanted to kidnap the governor of Michigan.
And Virginia.
You see the pictures coming out. I'm very glad the feds have arrested. I think they're saying like 300 people are going to get arrested. I'm very glad to see that, seeing these motherfuckers getting on no-fly lists, all that shit. But there's so many more. There are so many more out there. They're armed to the fucking teeth because they've been so afraid ever since Barack Obama that he was going to come and take their guns. It's going to get wild and crazy out here. And I'm hoping that the feds have just done a good enough job, because I've been online the last week on certain forums that if they knew who I was, maybe they treat me a certain way. The planning and the things that are happening.
Are you the Black
Klansman? Yeah, planning and the same thing.
The planning and things that have happened that they're doing out in the open.
Yeah, but if you can get on there, then the FBI is definitely already on there. And
yeah,
also,
but I also know
I have like 100 guns. So
the FBI, as far as their digital team, are not allowed to go online proactively to look for things based on their regulations. They have to be sent things, which I know a lot of people online have been sending them things. But the FBI is not allowed to hop online unless it's part of a certain – there's a lot of legal bullshit. But, I mean, what I've seen as far as car bombs, what I've seen as far as them wanting to leave guns inside the suburbs and knowing where to regroup and to do things, I just think that there's a good chance that there's going to be some bloodshed. I'm hoping that there's not. I just want everybody to be safe. And if you could stay the fuck home, stay the fuck home. This ain't our fight. If you're a Black Lives Matter anybody, let these stupid white motherfuckers get on with their war with blue lives. I don't fucking... It's our turn to stay the fuck out.
Mm-hmm. And I will be traveling. Oh, Lord.
Not till Thursday.
You'll be fine. No, I'm going down Wednesday night.
Yeah, you'll be fine.
Yeah.
But alrighty. Thanks for listening, ASOS. And it's been a long episode.
I was supposed to say something else. Oh. Shit. I forgot.
You want to say it for me?
Oh, yeah. The Death Star went boom. Whatever.
I like it.
Until next year. Until next year.
You know what's the best
fucking year?
The Death Star go boom. I guess Mark Davis will blow up the WNBA too. It all gonna go boom.
Wow.
Disrespectful.
All right, ladies.